On today's episode, a lot of injury news to break down, plus the rest of the matchups. And by the end of the show, I'm not sure you're going to want to take my advice anymore. Subscribe to this channel, like this video, and enjoy.
Hey, FootClan, football season is a time for excitement, so go ahead and switch things up with a new recipe from HelloFresh. With pre-measured ingredients and easy-to-follow directions, it's never been easier to try something new. Get up to 14 free meals, including free shipping, with the code FOOTBALLERS14 at HelloFresh.com/FOOTBALLERS14.
And FootClan, we want to thank Bombas for sponsoring today's show. When it comes to socks, they must be comfortable. And Bombas socks are the most comfortable that I have ever worn. Thank you, Andy. But that's just one reason why we love them. The other, look, they're a good company. They're helping their customers. And for every pair of Bombas you buy, they donate an item for those experiencing homelessness. Bombas started making socks, and after learning they're the number one most requested item in homeless shelters, they've started making underwear and shirts too. Bombas socks and underwear, t-shirts, they're super soft, and they're made to last with their 100% happiness guarantee. They're confident you'll be happy with your Bombas products or your money back. I'm a no-show sock type of fella. When I got my sneakers on, I don't want people seeing them. But my feet need to be comfortable, so I throw on the Bombas, and they take care of me. Oh, man, I'm loving it. There's so much more comfort to have and so much more to give with Bombas. Go get 20% off your first order at bombas.com/footballers. That's BOMBAS.com/footballers for 20% off your first order. Bombas.com/footballers.
Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Oh, welcome in. Welcome in, welcome back. Friday, October 15th, the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Jason Moore, Mike, the Fantasy Hitman Wright. I'm Andy Holloway. So much to talk about today. We've got a game to recap from last night. News and notes, injury talk, matchups. We've got the Wheel of Shame on today's show. Someone's spinning it. The guy who grunted over there.
The Wheel of Shame is a lot more fun.
On this side of the table?
When you're not spinning?
Yeah.
I had a great time the last couple of weeks.
So we also had some breaking news this morning. I don't know if you guys saw this, but superstar tight end Zach Ertz was traded from the Philadelphia Eagles. I don't know. Was he traded as he went into the end zone last night? I'm not sure. But, again, superstar, three-time Pro Bowler,
Zach Ertz
is heading to the Arizona Cardinals.
And you will notice there is no music accompanying this breaking news. I think it's good it's good for the Cardinals, it's good for the Eagles, and it's good for fantasy. It really is.
A win-win-win.
It is. It's a triple win because Zach Ertz becomes, I think, at least relevant, the higher-paced, better offense. And then, obviously, the big winner here is Dallas Goedert.
Yes, that is
having
correct.
Dallas Goedert finally be by himself. He was one of those guys coming into this season that we were all really high on. You know, I was always in the offseason, do I like Hockenson or Goedert more? Hockenson or Goedert?
Right.
Because I thought Zach Ertz was going to be gone. But now Zach Ertz is gone.
I mean, we have to say goodbye to the Goedert jokes. That's been a hard thing for me this morning. The Cardinals needed to replace Max Williams. He was heavily involved in the offense, like 16-17% target share. 16 targets over a couple of weeks or something. So Ertz is fine.
I've been getting tagged nonstop as I have been very vocal on my
opinion. I don't remember that.
Of Zach Ertz and his ability to play football. And I'm very excited that this happened, this trade. Because it was all a ruse. Zach Ertz, he's so incredible. All I've been doing is talking his value down so we can sneak him under the Arizona Cardinals.
You did it, Mike. You did it.
Steve Keim called
you up. You are welcome, Steve. I picked it up. I said, Steven, I'm going to keep talking crap about Zach Ertz, making that Philadelphia. I'm going to convince him that he sucks so that we can get him.
We did it.
This is what I tell myself.
Now, guys, how do you think
– Oh, come on.
How do you think – Dallas Goedert will do catching passes from Tim Tebow?
It's a great question. I was thinking this morning about
how
great a fantasy asset Jalen Hurts is, and how I've got him in our league of record. I've got him in Dynasty, and I was thinking I have got to trade him immediately in Dynasty.
Because he's not going to have a job.
Oh, no, he is not a long-term quarterback.
That's not a joke. We found our new Tim Tebow because everybody knew with your eyeballs that Tim Tebow was not going to be a professional quarterback long, and yet Jalen Hurts outscored Tom Brady last night.
Tim Tebow is unfortunately the comp because Jalen Hurts played a terrible game of football last night. And yet, at the very end of the game, his fantasy score was massive. He will easily be a top 10 quarterback on the week. I believe he had 3 total touchdowns, 2 rushing. And at the end of the game, if Philadelphia could have just made one stop, Jalen Hurts would have had an opportunity to go win the game.
It was crazy. It was crazy.
This game was out of control.
And we kind of knew it. Early in the game, it was looking terrible. And we're like, Jalen Hurts will just do a fourth quarter garbage time. You know, it took 90-something yards of PI penalties to get him on the goal line a couple times. He missed open receivers. I think Troy Aikman actually left the booth to go and strangle him at one point. way he was reading the defense.
They were very disappointed in Jalen Hurts.
Mad dads.
you have to understand, when they're commentating on this game, they have to watch it all. Like, we can take breaks. We can go to the kitchen, grab a snack, go to the bathroom.
Oh, a Hurts break.
Yes, exactly. A Hurts break. They couldn't. So they were getting very frustrated. And the reason we knew he was still going to have a ton of fantasy points when he's sucking all game long is because we have watched him every week do this. I mean, last week he was so bad, and then the fourth quarter comes around, he has like 5 fantasy points, and then they're down, and it's like, oh, just run the ball and run in touchdowns. And so he's great for fantasy. I think he's going to be a great fantasy quarterback this whole season, but in a dynasty league,
oh gosh,
I think you can get a good amount for him because he's literally dominating at the quarterback position points-wise, and I don't think that he is – look, the Eagles have 3 first-round picks. As of right now, I think they have 3 top 10 picks next year. That is draft capital to replace Jalen Hurts.
And I don't want to, like, just pile on infinitely. Like, I realize this is Jalen Hurts' 10th NFL start and all of those kind of disclaimers, but – it's the NFL. I mean, you get a certain amount of time to prove that you're going to be a franchise player, you know, and I don't think he has what it takes to do that. And so in dynasty leagues, fantasy-wise, they're going to find – I mean, is it Deshaun Watson? It might be. I mean, that draft capital for trading for Deshaun Watson is there too. So
sure,
they'll find somebody else. And until they do, I want to be clear about something. Miles Sanders, Kenny Gainwell, Devontae Smith – Jalen Rager, I mean, you're not going to be able to pick the week that one of them comes down with one of the 12 completions because it all works out. So it's going to be a rough road. Devontae Smith's been difficult to project in terms of when he delivers and when he doesn't. You know, the game script last night said that Devontae Smith should have had a better game.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
So, and it does seem like Quez Watkins is a better wide receiver than Jalen Rager.
He made difficult catches all
game long.
It's hard to argue against that. On the other side of the ball, Leonard Fournette has transformed into the full-time guy for Tampa Bay. And this, like, for fantasy, this is incredible. If you drafted Lenny late and held on through those first few weeks, I think congratulations, because you have at this point you have to project. This is a long-term fantasy football asset in Leonard Fournette. And Tom Brady, why you got to keep doing my man Mike Evans dirty like this? Every 3 games, we just give him 4 targets, and we're giving Antonio 13. Antonio's great. I understand. But come on. Mike Evans is a very good football player. He deserves more than 4 targets. This is a sham.
He just wasn't needed.
He was out there the whole game.
They gave him a goal line. They ran a goal line play to him. It just didn't work out.
Yeah, I mean, Mike Evans isn't going to be the volume guy. He's going to have his up games, his down games. Go trade for him if you want. He'll be fine on the course of the season. But it does seem like the kind of best of both worlds, where you get the kind of deep targets, the valuable end zone targets, but also the chain mover Seems like it's Antonio Brown.
I mean, this is a victory lap opportunity for Mike and then Jason too.
Well, thank
who just you guys were talking up Antonio Brown so early about that trend from last year, the targets. When push comes to shove, Tom Brady looks Antonio's way. When he got out of the pocket on that touchdown pass, he always gets a deep shot. Like you said, it's 13 targets. That's silly. So, I guess we can move on because it's Friday.
FootClan Friday.
Every Friday, we give away something special to a supporter of the show, this independent podcast. Join thefoot.com, where our community lives and breathes. This week's item from pristineauction.com, an Antonio Gibson signed jersey.
Oh, baby.
Evan Sather, congratulations. You win the Antonio Gibson signed jersey. You can go to pristineauction.com, use the code BALLERS, get a $10 credit. We're actually doing another giveaway at FootClanGiveaway.com for a Darren Waller jersey, and everybody can get in on that if you want to head over to FootClanGiveaway.com. Let's talk news.
News and notes from around the league, presented by Sleeper.
Today's news kind of, it's difficult because there's a lot of injury news, but there's not a lot of practice reports for Friday yet. Damian Williams was placed on the COVID list. This is a big deal.
News, yes.
Khalil Herbert.
Khalil Herbert is going to be the starting
last
running back.
Man standing.
And he's, I think he's a good play. If you picked him up in this week's waiver run, you saw it a week ago. It was pretty close to 50-50. Now, it seemed like Herbert was, you know, well, not seemed, it was. Herbert was getting his touches when they were, you know, trying to run out the clock. They were up, but they trusted Herbert with those carries, and now he will be the only guy for a team that desperately wants to run turtle.
Run turtle. I like it. Allen Robinson didn't practice on Thursday. Kyler Murray, limited. DeAndre Hopkins, illness, missed practice. Today's a big day for Hopkins. Lamar Jackson didn't practice due to an illness as well. Joe Judge said Daniel Jones looks like he'll be ready to play.
Okay.
So if you were hopeful or scared off of wide receivers because of Mike Glennon.
Yeah, it's good. It's a good little tap on the booty for Kadarius Toney. Like, it's all right. It's all right. You can
don't
still
tap too hard or he'll hit you back.
that's a good point.
TJ Hockenson limited on Thursday. He should play. Christian McCaffrey didn't practice Thursday. This is the big news.
He was limited Wednesday and then didn't practice Thursday. Whenever that happens, it is either someone's birthday, which you know, maybe I don't know his DOB, or something bad happened, and that's probably the case here. You know, I would expect if you don't practice on a Thursday after being limited Wednesday with the hamstring injury, you're not playing this week. And I just, I'm like staying away from Twitter because I don't want to see any kind of new news that goes the wrong direction.
You cannot escape your sleeper alert, Jason.
Yeah. Ian, you know, McCaffrey and Dalvin Cook were the two that were looking 50-50 coming into the week. McCaffrey trending not to play. Cook will play. He was a full participant, and Alexander Mattison is limited. So fist pumps from Mike.
Let's go, Dalvin.
Dalvin Cook's going to be back out there. Adam Thielen and Justin Jefferson did not practice on Thursday. I don't have any worry myself about these two guys, but keep your eyes on Friday's reports. Joe Mixon did not practice Thursday, but he is practicing on Friday, or at least going through warm-ups with the team.
This one's weird. This one is – I know we talked about Joe Mixon.
Pick up Chris Evans.
And, Jason, you had the confidence in Joe Mixon after the low snaps last week, you know, partially because Samaje Perine is likely not going to play because he is also on the COVID list. Are you still starting Joe Mixon with full confidence based on the news that we have?
If Joe Mixon starts, I will be starting Joe Mixon. It is certainly not with full confidence. I would pivot my start of the week, Joe Mixon, right across the field. Give me DeAndre Swift. You know, both of these running backs are in a good matchup. If Joe Mixon doesn't play, then Captain America is, you know, the matchup is very
Chris
good
Evans.
For him.
Yes.
Correct.
Yeah. I mean, the joke is great, but he's so unknown
yes,
that I
Chris
feel like
Evans
I have to say
back.
The name again.
Yeah, that's fair.
I mean somebody else has played Captain America probably.
Well, yeah. Not my lifetime.
You want to call him the Human Torch?
No.
Okay. Oh, I guess Captain America now has, like, shifted, right?
Well, yeah.
He played
Falcon
the Human Torch.
Yeah, Falcon is the new Captain America. Okay. All right. Well, Chris Evans then.
All righty. Big news. Nick Chubb did not practice. And
calf. And from what I saw
Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday.
I was going to say, from what I saw today, he was not out there. Kareem Hunt, who had been missing, was out there. So this one is a hold your breath. I mean, are you worried?
Most people with Nick Chubb don't have Kareem Hunt. And so you need a full pivot at the running back position, the hardest position to do that. So maybe that's Chris Evans. I think you could do it because regardless of Mixon's status, like Mixon proved last week, he can come in and get 30% of the snaps, do a little bit, and they'll manage him, and then Chris Evans would get most of the work. But it's a mess. I mean, unexpected for Nick Chubb. We didn't have really reason to be fearful until recently. Mm-hmm. Chris Carson didn't practice.
I mean, your pivot could be Alex Collins. We'll see if Carson is ruled out. He is the Sunday night game, which makes it very difficult for him to be your pivot because you don't. You probably won't know until in the afternoon on Sunday if Chris Carson is trending to playing or not, but he's someone you could pick up.
Yeah, unfortunately, last week they did the game time decision thing, and they waited until, you know, they wanted to see how he felt before the game. I can't imagine that a week of more rest says they're going to decide earlier, and this is a terrible – like my situation where I've got Christian McCaffrey, David Montgomery, and Clyde Edwards-Helaire, I have Alex Collins. I have him. And I think he would be a good play, but I don't have any other pivot option because it's Sunday night. And
I mean, the Monday game, you could go McNichols, you could go Singletary. I mean, those would be kind of backup pivots.
Yeah.
DK Metcalf didn't practice on Thursday with the foot. He has the Sunday night game. I was doing some reading on this. Seems like it's just managing the situation. I got a little worried, so I wanted to dig in, and I'm not as worried as I was. Damian Harris, limited practice on Thursday.
He still may not play, though.
Yeah.
We'll see.
Josh Jacobs didn't practice due to illness. Julio practiced in full.
That's great.
And Jarvis Landry was designated to return from IR, not been activated yet.
I mean, the Julio Jones one is great. You have far more confidence now in Ryan Tannehill, and especially we brought him up on the Never Not Working segment of last week. Looking forward to the bipocalypse of next week. Ryan Tannehill against the Kansas City Chiefs with both of his weapons, you should feel pretty good about that option.
Delicious.
Yes.
Yeah, I believe that those two guys, the big two, A.J. Brown and
Julio.
Yeah, and Julio Jones, have not been out there for, I think they've been out there 142 snaps together out of 384 on this season. So very limited amount of time playing together so far. There was not a lot of definitive final news in that injury report. And so it's one of the reasons we have the Injury Blitz podcast from our injury expert, Matthew Betts, available to you at jointhefoot.com. It's why we put game day alerts out. It's why Mike sits in the chair that I'm in right now on Sunday live to break it all down, to tilt with you, to make pivot suggestions. You can check all that out so you're ready to go. But use today to pick up some guys on the waiver wire if you have a queue next to the name. Plan ahead. Any other news, Brooksy, that has come in while I was giving news?
That's it for now, but we're watching.
All right. Definitely check out the Sleeper app. Get the breaking news alerts, and you'll be aware of what's going on. All right, before we jump back into the forecast and go through the rest of these matchups and, of course, make Mike spin the wheel of shame, we want to thank the sponsors supporting the podcast today. Absolutely love these guys. I'm talking about BlockFi. You could be a crypto pro. I mean, crypto is popping today.
It is.
And over this past week,
decade.
You could be a total beginner. But you can actually earn Bitcoin the easy way on BlockFi because they have the world's first Bitcoin rewards credit card. You can earn unlimited Bitcoin on every qualifying purchase that you make, which is pretty exciting. They're introducing this BlockFi Rewards Visa Signature Card everyday purchases. You go out and buy normal things, you get rewarded in Bitcoin, 1.5% back in Bitcoin on qualifying purchases. Kind of a neat way to start to accumulate some crypto. And so now is the time to start or ramp up your Bitcoin portfolio. Wow, 230% annualized return in 2020 for Bitcoin. Not bad. Right now, our listeners can get a bonus of $25 in crypto after you make your first purchase with the credit card when you sign up at BlockFi.com/footballers. That's a $25 bonus in crypto deposited right into your account after you make your first purchase. But you got to use our URL, BlockFi.com/footballers. Start earning Bitcoin back on all your qualifying purchases today, BlockFi.com/footballers. Not all will be eligible. Geographic, regulatory, and underwriting restrictions apply. Fees and terms are subject to change. Additional items and terms of service at BlockFi.com. BlockFi is a financial technology company. Banking services provided by Evolve Bank and Trust, member FDIC.
And we want to thank NetSuite. Look, there's three things slower than QuickBooks. The line at the DMV, watching paint dry, and a dead turtle.
Oh,
facts. Hashtag facts.
You really want to be in that league? QuickBooks sucks you in, slows you down with a manual process, integration difficulties, and glitchy delays that leave you scrambling for the numbers you need. Now is the time to make the switch to NetSuite by Oracle, the number one financial system, because NetSuite gives you visibility and control of your financials, your inventory, your HR, e-commerce, and more. It's everything you need to grow all in one place. With NetSuite, you can automate your process and close your books in no time, no matter how big your business grows. Failing to switch to NetSuite will leave you stuck trying to make sense of your books while competitors sprint ahead. 93% of surveyed businesses increase their visibility and control when switching to NetSuite. Special financing is back. NetSuite is offering a one-of-a-kind financing program only for those ready to switch today. Head to netsuite.com/footballers right now. That's special financing at netsuite.com/footballers. netsuite.com/footballers.
Fantasy forecast.
All right, if you want some of the matchups from yesterday's show, here's what we talked about then. The Dolphins, Jags, Packers, Bears, Bengals, Lions, Texans, Colts, Rams, Giants, Chiefs, and Washington, and the Vikings, Panthers. Those were yesterday's matchups, so click over to that episode and check them out. Today, six more games to talk about, starting with the, maybe my favorite team right now, the Los Angeles Chargers at 4-1, taking on the Baltimore Ravens, who have battled back to 4-1. Ravens feel weird. Because of the close, narrow win against Detroit and then losing to the Raiders and then, you know, up and down, they had to come back from a big deficit. They don't feel like they're kind
of... Their defense is not Ravens of old.
No, they're not in the groove right now, but the DraftKings Sportsbook line does have the Ravens as 2.5-point home favorites. The over-under is 51 points. And look, maybe Ravens fans don't like the fact their defense is in the groove, but fantasy fans like that. Especially if you have Justin Herbert, Austin Ekeler, Mike Williams, Keenan Allen, Jared Cook. I mean, is there anybody that you're lacking confidence in right now?
I mean, the only note here for me on the Chargers would be that Mike Williams has not practiced or didn't practice Wednesday or Thursday. So hopefully we at least get a limited on Friday. But otherwise, I mean, this is wheels up. You're playing everybody, and you're even willing to stream Jared Cook as the Ravens are 30th against fantasy tight ends.
Yeah, so pay attention to Mike Williams' injury news today. Austin Ekeler has been outstanding of late. Herbert obviously has been great. And for what it's worth, I mean, this could be really great. He's your default gut reaction when you see Baltimore in Baltimore is to kind of suppress the value of the quarterback.
Yes.
And yet Baltimore has given up 435-yard game to Derek Carr, huge game to Mahomes. A huge game to Carson Wentz.
Yeah, 402 yards to Carson Wentz. That's embarrassing.
So the confidence that you need in this game, yeah, fourth most passing yards allowed for Baltimore. And they've got some injuries, and they're dealing with that. Lamar, assuming he plays, I mean, he had the illness, missing practice. He's going to be in your lineup, as is Hollywood Brown. You're going to stay in those flames, as is Mark Andrews. So the real kind of confidence question regarding the Ravens is the running game. Is Tyson going to get more work magically?
Doubt it.
I don't think I think the experiment with Love Bell's over. Do you agree with that?
Yes. Yeah, it'll be the three-headed monster with Latavius Murray at the front. And I talked about him as my start of the week. That not that I'm not calling for Latavius Murray to have a weak winning running back here, but just saying I have the confidence that if Murray's on your bench, he is absolutely worth a flex play against a team giving up over 25 points a game to the running back position.
And I have a really hard time wanting to start these guys. Watching these games, it's just like I feel like if Latavius Murray doesn't get a touchdown, he won't be good. Like, you know, what's his – he's not involved in the passing game. So what's the most rushing yards he gets in this game? You know, is it like
– 60.
Yeah. So that's it. That's the game. That's 6 points. Yes. Now, if you get a touchdown, great. And I do have a league where I have to flex him, so I hope you're right here,
well,
Mike.
Let's say you have Latavius Murray and you're deciding on the injury dance of Joe Mixon. Are you playing Latavius or are you playing Mixon with limited snaps?
If Mixon is active, I would play Mixon over Latavius.
Okay. All right. Anything else you guys want to talk about in this one? I mean, Mike, to your point, Chargers giving up 25 fantasy points a game to opposing running backs. The 5-0 Arizona Cardinals with superstar Zach Ertz taking on the Cleveland Browns, who are 3-2.
Well, not with Zach Ertz.
No. And that I forgot to mention that. The world was set aflame with this trade news this morning, and they all wanted to know, could Zach Ertz play again and get two box scores from week 6?
Could I get both weeks?
Which, I mean...
Are you trying to kill the man?
If something is that crazy and does happen... I'm all about letting it happen, personally.
Oh, yeah.
But it's not allowed. The NFL does not allow a player to play more than one game per week. So Zach Ertz will have, 10 days to get acclimated in his new home. And the Cardinals will be without Zach Ertz and Max Williams in this
now,
game.
Now, what if...
And Rodney Hudson.
Is this like a calendar week, or is this Zach Ertz... What if Zach Ertz got traded to the Cardinals and we played on Monday nights?
I believe
technically
it is
a different week.
Yeah, no, I don't think you found the loophole there, Mike. But if they flex him into primetime, he could play.
All right.
No. The Cardinals, you know, they travel on the road here. The DraftKings Sportsbook line, Browns -3. The over-under is 49 points. You know, Nick Chubb could miss the game.
Oh, man.
And, I mean, for all we know, Hopkins could miss the game with this illness. Right now, no signs for that. I'd be much more concerned about Chubb.
49 points seems like a lot. You know what I mean? Like, this game, just everything is feels negative on the outlook, in the sense that, like, Baker hasn't been playing his best. Odell Beckham's been disappearing. Kyler's dealing with a shoulder injury. Hopkins has an illness. Chubb's not there. It's supposed to be windy, 17-mile-an-hour winds, which 15-plus mile-an-hours, where you start to kind of worry about the passing game a little bit. I don't know. The vibes just aren't good here, right? Am I missing something? I mean, you've got two good teams, two first, you know, picks at quarterback. Should be exciting, but I feel like this one's going to be a letdown.
So how will that affect the way you view fantasy players in this game? Are you adjusting expectations? Are there any significant benches? Like, would you bench all the non-Hopkins wideouts for Arizona because of that feeling?
Yeah, I'm less confident in playing them, and usually when you're playing AJ Green and Christian Kirk, Rondale Moore, what you're doing is you're taking a shot at a piece of the 35 points they're going to be put up, and I'm not sure that that's going to happen with no Rodney Hudson and a great pass rush from the Cleveland Browns. Rodney Hudson, the center for the Arizona Cardinals. I don't know how big a pie you're going to get in this game. So, yeah, those ancillary pieces I'm not so sure about. I'm still starting Kyler Murray. I was asked on local radio this morning, like, are you starting Kyler Murray or Trevor Lawrence because of the shoulder? And I would not be okay losing with Kyler Murray on the bench while he has a good game. I would be okay starting Kyler Murray and losing and him having an off week. I've talked about trading high. If you could capitalize and get a haul for Kyler and avoid the situation altogether, but if he's on your roster, you play him.
And perhaps you think twice about the potential of James Conner, who's, I mean, been very viable for fantasy, but it's touchdowns. So if you're projecting that the Cardinals will have fewer touchdown opportunities in this game, then Conner's not someone you want to desperation flex.
I think Chase Edmonds is the play. This game, I think when you lose your tight end, you don't have Ertz or Max Williams for this week. You have a pass rush that Jason just mentioned. And Chase Edmonds is a receiver at the running back position. I think he may be. What if Hopkins misses? I mean, Edmonds is going to be very, very necessary in this game.
That makes a lot of sense to me. It does. Like that, you know, that narrative of how that game could go really does make sense. But while you're saying that, it kind of illuminates maybe the need for Rondale Moore a little bit more too. The screen game, the manufacturer get the ball out quick and let a player do some. So maybe a little bit more confidence in Rondale Moore.
But wide receiver wise, you know,
well, as we're talking, Hopkins was back during the open portion of practice today.
Well, that's good news. To remove that potential variable. Cardinals defense has been really, really good. They're number one against opposing tight ends. They were great last year against tight ends after their, like, I think 2 years ago it was a disaster. Great against opposing quarterbacks, opposing running backs. There aren't wide receivers that give you great confidence. You know, last week was a Donovan Peoples-Jones game, but he disappeared for weeks before that. Landry could be back. I don't know if you are confidently playing any Browns outside
of Kareem Hunt. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean,
I would probably bench everybody else.
I would agree, other than if Nick Chubb is active, I'm still going to start Nick Chubb.
Yeah, no doubt. The Raiders at 3-2 take on the 3-2 Denver Broncos. The DraftKings Sportsbook line have the Broncos -3.5, over-under's 43.5. Raiders been in the thick of Distractionville, and they've lost a couple in a row. Josh Jacobs, 5 targets each of the last 2 weeks.
That's something.
He does seem to be. Now, Peyton Barber's expected to be back.
Oh, thank goodness.
I'm not really worried about that. Man.
Raider Nation, breathe a sigh of relief. Peyton Barber, he's back.
Broncos defense has been stout. Second against quarterbacks, third against running backs, third against tight ends. You know,
divisional matchup, this could be a real ugly slugfest.
I would take the. I think it's going to be an ugly slugfest, a 17-14 type of game. And, you know, the Broncos have not been great. You know, Cortland Sutton's going to be in my lineup.
Yeah, Cortland Sutton will be there. I'm not confident. I mean, Melvin Gordon, Javonte Williams, you're going to keep getting what you've got, which is a split backfield, opportunities for, you know, falling into the end zone.
Do we have an update on Melvin Gordon's health? Sorry, Jason.
No, I mean, that's obviously important here because Javonte would go from someone I don't want to play to someone who would be in all my lineups if he was alone.
Melvin is just that he was limited yesterday. That's what I have last.
Okay. Right. So I would expect him to be out there. I mean, yeah, Cortland Sutton is there. Tim Patrick is fine as a low-end flex.
This isn't really the matchup that I'm hoping to play Fireball in.
Can I give a little dynasty thought? I've come to terms with, and I put it into action yesterday. Look, I traded Jason. We had a bigger trade with Zeke and Mark Andrews, and I got Noah Fant back, and I've had Noah Fant starting in a couple leagues. I don't like Noah Fant long term.
Interesting.
Like, I've watched these games closely, and unfortunately I just see more of a. I'm not seeing the special level of tight end with Noah Fant on the field, so I shipped him off in a dynasty league. I traded for Dawson Knox. He's only scored in double digits 22% of the time. Visually, watching the games, I mean, he's had such opportunity, right?
Yeah.
Perceptual opportunity where you lose.
Yes, he should be dominating.
Yeah, exactly.
It's so funny.
And I've watched him, and I think he looks kind of slow, a little bigger than he used to.
I'm laughing because the same exact thing happened to me where when you have him, when you're relying on Noah Fant, we're humans, right? You're watching these games and you're paying real special attention to the players that you're rooting for, the players you need points, you know, out of. And all of a sudden, when you're watching him, you're like, I just don't know if he's ever going to do it. And so that's part of why I traded him away. Then you grab him, you're playing him, and you're watching him, and you're like, I'm just not sure he's ever going to really do it.
Yeah, because the name still demands
high draft capital, yeah. Super athlete.
But 30th and 32nd in 2 of the last 3 weeks. He got into the end zone to finish at tight end 9, but you should have seen better than tight end 9 over these last 3 weeks with the limited pass-catching options in Denver. So that's just kind of a, you know, all that to say you might not have a better option. You always have a chance at a touchdown with him in this matchup, and the Raiders haven't been great against tight ends, but dynasty-wise, I'm a little worried.
And this isn't the matchup that I would love Hunter Renfro or Ruggs or Bryan Edwards. There's barn burners where you're just wanting a piece of a big pie. This doesn't strike me as where I'd like to start them.
The Dallas Cowboys at 4-1 take on the New England Patriots, who are 2-3. They were so close to being 1-4 with Houston defeating them last week.
Houston should have won that game.
Yes.
They really should have. DraftKings Sportsbook line here, Cowboys -3.5 on the road in Foxborough.
Oof.
The over-under is 50.5 points. Cowboys are playing great. New England has yet to find itself on defense. You know, last week, what they gave up big play-wise over and over again to Davis Mills was worrisome the same week that they traded Stephon Gilmore away. So, or let him go. So, I don't know. I don't think I have any hesitation with the big Dallas pieces in this game.
No, I don't either. I think that the Patriots are a pretty good defense, but Dallas is a just better team. They're just going to go in there, and I think they're going to beat them up. We've seen Dallas do it every which way. Week one, we know they can air it out. They can throw the ball for a kajillion yards. But if they're winning the game, which they're favored, and I think they're the better team here, they have been running the ball since that first week. They've got the third highest rush rate, slowing the pace down. It's not great for fantasy, but it's great for the Dallas Cowboys record and getting victories at the end of the game. So they're going to keep doing that. I'm not afraid of Zeke, Cooper, or Lamb. All three of those guys are every single week starters, no matter matchup.
And I believe it was on the Green Room show where we were getting questions because, you know, like, should I be concerned about this player? And people are saying, well, I'm confused. What's going on with CeeDee Lamb? What's going on with the breakout of Amari Cooper? And to highlight this, because I don't think that he still is not.
Who are you talking about?
I'm going to get there. He's not at the fantasy respect level that he should be. And the thing that's happened to CeeDee Lamb is Dalton Schultz, the tight end. I mean, look, I wanted it to be Jarwin. It's not. It's Dalton Schultz. Over the last 3 weeks, Dalton Schultz has seen 29% of the targets, and the pie has been smaller. So if you're wondering what's going on with your wide receivers, it's not that CeeDee Lamb is bad. It's that Dak Prescott has a new best friend in Dalton Schultz, who should be respected as a top tight end option for the foreseeable future.
He's looked great. I've looked to pick him up, and now would you go trade? Let me ask you this. Would you trade Noah Fant away for Dalton Schultz in the short-term view?
Yes.
Short-term, absolutely. I think Schultz is quickly becoming that second tier of tight end where you need to start them.
One bit of update for you. One bit of update. I've never said that sentence before.
Little bit update.
New bit update. Little bit update. Mixon, normal workload according to Zach Taylor.
I hope he knows more than the beat reporters from last week, but that's great.
Seems like a better source.
It does seem like a pretty good source. Now remind me, Zach Taylor, head coach?
Yeah.
Great.
Now, Mike, I wanted to ask you about the running game for New England because I think people are trying to find opportunity.
No.
Okay.
Don't.
Thank you. That's
the right answer.
That's what we needed to hear. But the defense, Dallas has actually been good against the run, and then you're sifting through the rubble here trying to find Brandon Bolden or Ramondre or Damian Harris limited, and no is a good answer.
Yeah, for like Harris should be on your bench. He should not be dropped or anything like that. He's a fine he's good for your fantasy football team, but you have to find the right places to play him. Against Dallas, that coming off of a chest injury, we don't know if he's going to suit up, but this is not the week. But next week he gets the New York Jets. Yeah, I'll play Damian Harris in that matchup, and I do think because I picked him up. I overpaid a lot in Fab to pick him up yesterday, but
to pick who up?
To pick up Ramondre Stevenson, who to me is worth a stash and see what's going on because this running back room is in transition. It's in turmoil. We don't know exactly what's going on, and Ramondre, by the end of the year, could end up being the primary ball carrier, and he actually has a decent skill set at catching the ball, better than Damien Harris, so he could see an uptick in usage there.
He's one of my favorite stashes.
Yes,
you're not picking him up and putting him in your lineup and expecting great things right now, but Ramondre Stevenson at running back is a good pickup and stash. Wait and see what you have here. He has the talent, and I think he could have an impact as the season goes on.
The hardest thing about New England is how many years has it been since we've seen an explosive offensive performance?
How many years has it been since they've had Tom Brady?
Yeah, I mean, it's like the ceiling. It's like if any player achieves their pinnacle goals for this team, you still are going up against the bottom third scoring team.
Yeah, you're still disappointed. That's why Jacoby Myers is okay, because his pinnacle is what he's been doing, which is like 8 for 80, and that's a fine fantasy, you know, day. This is a
he was
game.
Tackled at the one last week.
We're
getting closer.
Well, he got to the force field. he's not allowed to break through the force field of the
like
end zone.
It's like the dome.
Yeah.
The show.
Absolutely.
There's an invisible dome for Jacoby.
He was tackled with no defenders.
Did you guys see the play?
I did see the play.
It was a screen pass. It was like 100%. We're calling this to get Jacoby his first touchdown. It was like, oh, this should work. We'll get him that quick touchdown. Still didn't work. Hunter Henry is a play, though, to me. I think Hunter Henry in this matchup against Dallas, Dallas should put up points, and Henry has separated himself, running more routes than Janu, and so I would look that direction.
Yeah, you saw 29% of the targets last week. That's wild.
The 2-3 Seahawks take on the 2-3 Pittsburgh Steelers in Pittsburgh. The DraftKings Sportsbook line, Steelers -5.5. The over-under is 43. Pittsburgh should get back to .500 in this game. They get the benefit of not facing Russell Wilson. Geno Smith will be the quarterback for the Seattle Seahawks. And by the way, the practice reports yesterday for Seattle were ridiculous. You know who was limited in practice?
Everyone.
Russell Wilson. That's what he was listed as.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean,
so
he's...
Well, he can do everything on the football field except throw a football.
Right. Well,
he can run just fine.
If there was one player, one ever, to pull a Larry Bird and come out here and try to play quarterback left-handed, just like, dude, I'm still better than...
A left-handed Russell might be better than Geno Smith.
Yeah.
This is a tough thing, right? Because you face a pretty good defense, especially against the run, against tight ends. Pittsburgh seemed to figure some things out last week. I'm laughing at this comment because the note I have under Big Ben Roethlisberger from Kyle was that he used to play football professionally.
Oh, man.
Get
but Pittsburgh should win this game. I mean, you got to like Najee, Deontay, Claypool.
Yep.
And is there any chance that you would play Big Ben? Because
no.
I know we've never said that out loud, but Seattle's defense struggling. Short fields, touchdown opportunities maybe?
Yeah, the touchdown opportunities for sure. You would assume higher odds for Najee than for the wide receivers. This is one of those games where when you look at the defense and what Seattle has given up, they're a poor defense. You can't really like the Kansas City Chiefs. They're a bad defense. They give up a ton of points. But part of the reason they do is because Patrick Mahomes goes out there and puts up so many points that you have to on every fourth down.
Is the Kansas City defense upset with Patrick Mahomes?
Yeah.
They're like, slow down, man.
They're like, you make the other team always want to score so much. But similar things here with Russ. With a worse offense for the Seahawks, there will be, you know, more potential for the game clock to run out early, run Najee, not have to try to put up 40 points to win the game.
Any chance you're pivoting from the wide receivers on Seattle?
On Seattle?
No.
Lockett is someone that I'm a little bit scared of. His mind meld with Russell Wilson is otherworldly, and I'm not pivoting from him to a Jacoby Myers. But if I've got another good option.
Julio?
Yeah, if Julio's active.
I'd play Julio.
I would play Julio as well.
Because of the quarterback
Tyler Boyd
situation.
Versus Tyler Lockett?
I'd play Lockett.
I would go Lockett there.
It will be interesting to see what this offense does for Seattle. Because the new quarterback, you can't just say, hey, go do what Russell Wilson does. So do they bring shorter targets in here that and the Seattle wide receivers actually become a little bit more consistent? Maybe not at the... as explosive, but gets more consistent production.
Well, Pat Freiermuth, I did see a stat that Big Ben.
Is he Luth?
His passer rating throwing the ball to Pat Freiermuth is like 125.
That makes sense.
Yes.
He's Muth. I mean, let him Luth.
just let him Luth.
He's
just Luth in the reins.
Just Luth in the reins and let Muth go everywhere.
Pittsburgh, let him Luth.
Yeah. Oh, man, I love Pat Freiermuth.
I can hear Al Borland just cackling like a little kid in the background.
That gets me, man.
Yeah?
Just,
what gets you exactly? Like
just
when,
let him loof.
When the mooth is loof. Yeah. Yeah, say it at home. Say it with us.
Now, Brooks, does that make you cackle at all?
Oh, yeah.
All right.
What is that again?
Good, gives me a good chuckle.
What does?
What does?
The mooth is loose.
The mooth. Oh, fantastic.
All right. Monday
Thank
night.
You for letting us not I, gloss you know over the mute.
Yes.
Once I saw that tweet, I knew I'd bring him up in the matchups. Buffalo, 4-1. Tennessee, 3-2. DraftKings Sportsbook line for Monday Night Football. The Bills, -5.5. The over-under is 53. I don't think anybody's playing better than the Bills right now. And the Tennessee defense, frankly, there are two outcomes for this game. Tennessee's offense figures it out, or Tennessee gets blown out. I mean, those are the outcomes, right?
Yeah, that is what it seems like.
The over-under is 53. Now, there's a chance that they figure it out, and it doesn't matter because Buffalo's been the best defense in football. But at least you got a shot at it, right? Like, fantasy players would like to see last Monday night.
Yes.
So, are you confident with the running backs on Buffalo because of the matchup with Tennessee?
Just Zach Moss. He's become the guy. The last few weeks, we saw it happening where after the weird week one situation, Zach Moss has looked good on the field. He's getting end zone. He's getting goal line carries. And then we saw the snaps jumped up to 74% against Kansas City. So that's just a sign of things to come, that they're going to make the move to Zach Moss. And that's great. Like if Zach Moss can become a reliable fantasy option for a very high powered offense, like that's great for fantasy football.
I agree. And the truth is they're going to be in these positive game scripts the majority of the time that they play football. And so that gives me more confidence in Moss.
Four targets for Moss last week. I mean, that's good stuff.
I expect big things from Stephon Diggs this week. Tennessee is dead last in the NFL against opposing fantasy wideouts. So
they're giving up 40 points per game to the wide receivers, fantasy points per game in half point. That is great.
And I would – so Emmanuel Sanders is back in there.
Yeah.
The only area they've been strong against so far, and I haven't looked at all their opponents, but it's been the tight end position, but you're still putting Dawson Knox back out there.
You have to.
He's running so many routes.
Mm-hmm.
And really seems like they have marginalized Cole Beasley. I mean, between Sanders and Dawson Knox, Cole Beasley's been far less important. Like Emmanuel Sanders or Tyler Lockett? That's a
Ooh,
question coming in from.
That's a.
I would play Emmanuel Sanders for sure.
Man.
I think that there's a good consideration. It's not locked and loaded, clear and obvious. But if it was my roster, I would play Emmanuel Sanders. The matchup is fantastic. The quarterback is a known commodity. He's been very good. I don't see why I would pivot other than just hoping that they'll have some new game plan for Geno where they throw it to Tyler Lockett short all the time.
Yeah. Josh Allen, greater sign, Geno Smith, I think.
Yeah.
Josh Allen has increased his average depth of target from last year to this year. He's second in the league. He's 137.6 passer rating on 10-plus yard throws. It's the best in the NFL. We just saw a graphic that went up on Twitter that showed the last 21
games yeah.
between Patrick Mahomes and Josh Allen, and they're indistinguishable in terms of touchdown to interception ratio, win-loss record. It's incredible what Josh Allen has been able to do and then sustain it. You know, Josh Allen is here to stay, and the Bills are here to stay because of it every year for a long, long time. So on the other side of the ball, though, Derrick Henry's always in your lineup.
Mm-hmm.
Tannehill, it's a tough sell on Tannehill. You just need to wait and see if you get two healthy wideouts at the end of this game moving into next week against Kansas City.
100%. I'm benching Ryan Tannehill here. There are too many really good options to stream at quarterback that are easy and obvious that I would put ahead of Ryan Tannehill this week. But again, have him on your bench for next week against Kansas City.
Yep. And then A.J. Brown, I mean, I don't have a tremendous amount of confidence in him this week.
I don't have confidence for upside, but I'm still starting him as like a low-end wide receiver too.
Yeah, it's tough because you've had injury, but you also had like the bad performance, right? Like 4 of 8 targets, 3 of 9 targets to start the year, 3 of 6 targets last week. You haven't seen it this year yet, which is just
unfortunate. You probably don't have a better option.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. Haven't seen this year, too. But the fact that he's caught 40% of his passes over the course of this season so far, 10 out of 25. He's not a 40% catch rate guy. I mean, nobody is.
This year he is.
He has been, but he's a 65% catch rate player with Tannehill over the course of his career. So I'm not too worried about the bad performances. He'll right the ship.
All right, Lamar Jackson did return to practice on Friday, so that's good news. You probably weren't scared. Terry McLaurin spent time with the training staff on Friday.
No.
They also said he rejoined his teammates on the main field. Mm. So we're not
good.
We're not exactly sure what's going on. It's never a good tweet to read that someone's on the side with the training staff, but as of now I would think he's okay.
Brooksy, how long is the Injury Blitz podcast on average when Betsy puts it out there? Like 15 minutes?
Yeah, right around.
Breaking news.
Browns running back Nick Chubb has been ruled out.
Wow.
For Sunday's game against the Arizona Cardinals.
So should I feel good about playing somebody that has Kareem Hunt right now?
No.
It's funny, though, because Kareem Hunt.
Should I feel good about trading for Kareem Hunt last week?
Oh, yeah, you did, didn't you?
I did.
Yeah.
It also appears that Christian McCaffrey is not at practice again today.
Come on, what's wrong with your potty?
Sorry, go ahead, continue.
You doing okay?
I've had Christian McCaffrey for 2 years.
Yeah.
It's been a bad 2 years.
You haven't got to enjoy nothing.
Nothing. What does it cost you?
You keep
everything.
You get on the bus, you drive into town, you try to open the door to the candy store.
Yeah. Oh, there.
And the candy store is always closed, and you got to get back in the bus and drive back home.
Someone keeps stealing the wheels off my Lamborghini. I haven't been able to drive it. I've got a beautiful Lambo, and I shouldn't park it outside, but I want people to see it, and they come by and they take the wheels, and then I can't drive
it. You can never drive it.
Oh.
All right, it's time to move on. By the way, I think I was saying the Injury Blitz podcast again. Just there's so much going on right now that is crucial for this week.
The question is, how quickly can I get Kareem Hunt into my DraftKings lineup before we go?
Nope.
Fantasy Faceoff, presented by DraftKings.
That could still be a trap. For two reasons. Number one, Arizona's defense has been outstanding against running backs.
Fantasy points given up. We're still giving up a very high yards per carry, though.
But number two, Kareem Hunt historically has not been as good when Nick Chubb missed. I mean, he hasn't. I had him last year during all of the missed Nick Chubb games. It was not a treat.
He had the opportunity to do what we thought he was going to do, which is just be a top five absolute dominating force while Chubb was down. He didn't do that. However, we've seen the same thing with Alexander Mattison. He had the opportunity. He failed. A smaller sample size with Mattison. And then this year, he's really come through. So there is still hope that Hunt becomes a top five guy.
I don't think he's a top five guy this week.
I think he's a great play this week, though. Great.
Well, let's move on. Fantasy Faceoff here, brought to you by DraftKings. Last week, I whipped your booty.
Yeah,
you whooped most people's booty. I had a great lineup.
Yes.
And you whooped my booty. I mean, I cashed everywhere with this lineup.
Last week, your lineup that you set for this Fantasy Faceoff finished 22 in the milli maker.
So that's like 200,000 lineups?
Yeah. So
237,000.
Not only did you beat the two of us,
but who's counting?
It was one of the best lineups possible for the week.
My favorite part was, well, two things. I got a lot of tweets of people are like, I just played your lineup and I won a bunch of money, and that's cool. But the other fun tweets were like, why didn't you share this lineup with us? What? Because when they found out I finished 22nd, they're like, why don't you put this out there anywhere? Why don't you share?
To which you replied, why don't you listen to our Friday episodes?
I was like, it's literally the lineup I announced on the show. So
Those people would have got muted.
Mike, you ended up at the basement because Jason did have a pretty good week. And so
thanks, LaVisca.
Congratulations. Let's do it.
Wheel of Shame.
Now, last time you had the messy lipstick, right? When I had the privilege of
yeah, that was good. It was a good time.
All right, let's spin it again, Al. Oh, boy.
Okay, so we got
see the fedoras.
Jester hat, farmer hat.
Baby bonnet. That
Uncle
was
Sam. Oh, we got a clown wig. Is that what? Clown wig.
Clown wig. Well, I got some accessories, too. Don't worry about that.
There's some. There's clown accessories?
I hope so.
Are they,
yeah,
okay,
so Mike is pulling
they're bundled
out.
Inside the wig.
I mean,
all
you're
right.
going to have to switch hats here. You got to get rid of your son's hat.
Well, I got to figure out how to get inside this thing, okay?
Yeah. Oh, beautiful. I love
we
the bow
tie. We have a few accessories.
All right. So for those listening at home, number one, you just go to our YouTube.
Yeah.
But there's the wig, a bow tie. I got to go bow tie first, I
you
suppose,
do. You
right?
got to slip that one over.
Oh, this is outstanding. You got the big bow tie, the white gloves, the clown wig, and I think best of all.
I didn't know that you were going to have me dress up as Matt Nagy.
The
red nose.
Yeah, the gloves are, I mean, those are optional.
this is terrible.
But now get the, you need the you nose got, on.
Well, okay.
It's clutch. All Does right. it fit? Oh, baby.
Oh, yeah. Looking all good, right. Mike. Bozo over
this
here.
This is the worst.
Yeah, who's taking your opinion serious this week? Anybody starting a lineup from that guy? All right.
I'm telling you, you can't miss.
Honk, honk.
Delightful. Oh, man, those gloves. I don't know if they're going to fit you.
They
but...
look tiny.
Oh, no, they're good. They're good. He's putting them on. All right, I'll get into the lineup here. Oh, my goodness.
Who do you have at quarterback, Andy? Is it going to surprise anybody?
Yeah, it is. I have Joe Burrow. I took Joe Burrow at quarterback. I had thought about going.
I can't use my computer with the gloves.
Oh, man, I love winning. Winning is fun. I went Joe Burrow. I thought he was the right balance between affordability and upside.
I like it. He's my start of the week.
The Detroit matchup, the big playability, the stack. So I went Joe Burrow against Detroit. I'm curious, Jason, you were thinking about an expensive and a cheap option. Which did you go with?
I had really thought about building around Taylor Heineke, but then this is a cash version. And that's something worth at least saying on the show. Like, I know people played this lineup in the Millie Maker and it did well, but we're building these actually for more cash games to beat two people versus beating 200,000. I went Patrick Mahomes against Washington, who's been giving it up without, you know, Clyde Edwards-Helaire there. I think Mahomes coming off a loss. I just want all those points in cash. He's expensive at 8,300, but it was worth it. And I assume, Mike, did you go Mahomes as well?
Beep, beep. I took Mahomes too.
Oh, really? You both have Mahomes?
Boop.
All right.
Aruga.
At running back, I went with...
I kind of got a Bob Ross thing going on.
You do have a little bit of a Bob Ross.
But like a real colorful
Bozo trait. Ross. Yeah.
Yes.
I went Austin Eckler and Daryl Henderson. So Austin Eckler against Baltimore, staying in the Flames with the value, PPR. And then Daryl Henderson against New York, who was my start of the week at running back. So
I went Austin Eckler as well.
Oh, boy.
Great PPR option. And Jonathan Taylor against Houston. Those are my two running backs.
Not bad.
All right, we have a little bit of overlap. I also have Daryl Henderson at 6. I can't even talk in the microphone with this
Can't
nose.
Take yourself seriously.
I got Henderson, and I went I went with DeAndre Swift at 6,300.
I can't look at you. DeAndre Swift. All right, my wideouts. Devontae Adams. You ever heard of him? I went with Devontae Adams.
Oh, that guy? You're going back to that
yeah,
well?
I'm spinning up on that.
You coward.
Yeah, and then I'm going Jamar Chase to stack with Joe Burrow.
Okay.
Against Detroit, big play. And then I went with DeAndre Carter. I went with the very bargain
okay,
basement, $3,000 DeAndre Carter for Washington. It's a scary pick, but it let me spend up elsewhere.
Yeah, well, it was a scary pick for me as well. DeAndre Carter
right.
for $3,000.
Oh, I can't wait for De'Ami Brown to play.
McLaurin went off to the sideline this week.
Against Kansas City at $3,000, which is the basement for wide receivers. He's a good value. I also have Jamar Chase.
Oh, boy.
So the difference,
make it three.
Devontae,
beep, beep.
You've got Devontae Adams. I've got Keenan Allen.
All right, so I have Jamar Chase. For my Patrick Mahomes super stack, I'm going with budding superstar Mecole Hardman.
Okay.
Who saw a bunch of targets last week. He's only 4,200. And currently I have Terry McLaurin in at 7,100. But we'll see if he actually plays, if I have to pivot that decision or not.
All right, at tight end, I'll give you my tight end, my flex, and my defense. My tight end is Ricky Seals-Jones. for Washington. So I'm looking at peripheral targets in Washington outside of McLaurin in that matchup with Kansas City.
There's so much snot in this clown nose
now. That's terrible.
What's wrong with your nose? Stop blowing snot into it.
It's just it's giving me a runny nose, and it's got nowhere to run.
Oh, stay away. Rondale Moore. I'm taking the shot on Rondale Moore in my flex position against Cleveland, and then I'm going with the Colts defense against Houston.
All right. I also have Ricky Seals-Jones at tight end.
Make him three.
You have Carter. Oh, we all have Jones?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because he's 3,000.
He's
yeah.
3,000, and he's going to get a lot of targets against Kansas City. I've got Darrell Williams at my flex.
Okay.
At 4,900.
Running back for the Chiefs.
Yep, running back for the Chiefs. Very good value. And the Carolina Panthers defense against Minnesota at home for 2,900.
I have Ricky Seals-Jones, as I mentioned, and then I have Brandon Cooks taking on the Colts at 5,800. And for my defense, I am reluctantly playing the Cleveland Browns against my Arizona Cardinals.
All right. Well, that'll do it. Download the DraftKings app right now. Use the code BALLERS this week. New customers can get a free shot at millions of dollars in total prizes. That's the code BALLERS, only at DraftKings, the official daily fantasy partner of the NFL. That's a minimum $5 deposit requirement. Eligibility restrictions apply. See DraftKings.com for details. I'm going to give Brooks another second to break in with some surprising injury news. Today has felt like a whirlwind. You got anything for us, or are we all okay?
Nothing surprising. Nope.
All right. Well, Sunday Live with this clown, an hour before kickoff at ballerslive.com. Hope you enjoyed today's episode, and we wish you the best of luck in Week 6.
Bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter @TheFFBallers.